بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا وقدوتنا وقائدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه، علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما، أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بالنور الفهم، وأنعم علينا يا عظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and peace be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah Almighty, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. My brothers and sisters, last week was a very important lesson for every single Muslim who believes in Allah and His Messenger. And last week's lesson was about the Battle of Uhud. And we heard how the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as usually comes to the believers, this time the victory was not with the believers due to a very integral and important point in the Muslim life, and that is the obedience to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's victory is not connected, or it's not pertained, and it's not linked to the number of the army. Nor Allah's victory is linked to the weapons of the Muslim army. Nor that the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is linked to the physical strength of the Muslims' army, but Allah's victory is linked to His obedience and the obedience of His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why we see in the Battle of Badr, where the Muslims were unprepared and they fought an army that was prepared, and the army of the non-believers exceeded the number of the believers by 2 to 3 times. But yet, because of the iman first of all and the taqwa of the believers and their reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obedience to Allah and His Messenger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them victory. In the Battle of Uhud, they were a lot more prepared. The believers were a lot more prepared, a lot more stronger in their numbers, a lot more experienced. But because of their disobedience to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they did not experience victory. And this is a very important point for every single Muslim to know, that the obedience of Allah and His Messenger is so important in their life that no success, no victory, no opening, no happiness, no good time will ever come without obeying Allah and His Messenger. So the obedience of Allah and His Messenger is so important in our life. And let never ever be deceived by saying that the obedience is only to Allah and the following is only to the Quran. No. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam warns, and he says, there will be people after me, they'll say, whatever we find in a book of Allah will follow, whatever we do not find will we do not follow. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says, by Allah, in which my soul is at, the obedience of Muhammad is the same way obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever Muhammad says is whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his obedience is as important it is obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the following the Quran al-Kareem. And we heard after the battle of Uhud how exhausted the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, and him and the companions were, and how the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam went back to Medina carrying the bad news that a lot of the people of Medina were expecting. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to strengthen the enthusiasm and the motivation of the companions and the believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to teach the non-believers a good lesson. That at the end of the day, every sword that's been drawn is drawn for the sake of Allah. And every fight that's been fought is being fought for the sake of Allah. And every step they've stepped, they stepped for the sake of Allah. And every energy they've exhausted it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam went back to Medina. The next day, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam prepared the same number of people. He came out with him in a battle of Uhud to come out with him sallallahu alayhi wasallam and to go into Hamra al-Asad. Hamra al-Asad, it's between Mecca and Medina, and more closer to Medina than Mecca. And there the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam will order every companion and every believer that participated with him in the battle of Uhud to come out with him to Hamra al-Asad. And the whole point that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam wanted from behind going to Hamra al-Asad, even though the companions were so exhausted, so tired, is to send a strong message across to the non-believers, do not even think of coming back and attacking the Medina. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the army are still strong, and the believers are still strong, and they're willing to fight and continue to fight. That one of the Bedouins went past the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam on his way traveling to Mecca. He was not a Muslim, and he embraced Islam at that time that he met the Prophet alaihi wasallam in Hamra al-Asad. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told him, his name is Ma'bad ibn Abi Ma'bad al-Khuza'i, that if he sees the people of Quraysh, to inform them that Muhammad had came out with a larger number of the number that he came out to Uhud. So Ma'bad radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he went traveling towards Mecca, he met Abu Sufyan and his army. And he told Abu Sufyan, Abu Sufyan, by Allah on my way, I saw Muhammad coming out with a number larger than the number that he came out to Uhud with. I've never seen a number of an army the way I've seen Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his people. Wow! Just before Ma'bad arriving to Abu Sufyan, the people of Quraysh were thinking to come back and hit the Medina once again and maybe destroy the Medina and the people of Medina at once. But when the news came to them that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came out with a large number of his people, still strong and firm and willing to fight, this brought the fear in their hearts. That they thought again about going back. At the end, Abu Sufyan decided to continue his trip to Mecca, where they were on the edge of coming back and attacking the Medina. And this was not only a strong message to the people of Mecca, but there was a strong message to the Bedouins that were living around Medina. Whoever thought to come and attack the Medina or attack the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, especially after the news that came out that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam and his army, the Muslims, had lost the battle against the people of Mecca in Uhud. Now the news comes out as stronger news from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that Muhammad is still strong, and don't you ever think of attacking Medina. Don't you ever think of going near any Muslim. We are still strong, we are still fit, and we will continue to fight to the end. So that was the message that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam wanted to send across. While Abu Sufyan was traveling, there was a group, a caravan from Abd al-Qais, a tribe called Abd al-Qais, and they were traveling towards Medina. Abu Sufyan wanted to play with words, and he wanted to politically put fear and threat into the hearts of the believers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Abu Sufyan told that caravan that were traveling from Mecca towards Medina, he said, if you go past Muhammad, I want you to do me a favor. In return, I'll give you something when you come to Mecca the next time. So they said, what is it? So Abu Sufyan told that caravan to inform Muhammad that the non-believers, that the people of Quraysh, had gathered a huge number of people to come and attack you. This is the propaganda that Abu Sufyan wanted to play to send the fear and the hesitance in the hearts of the believers. He thinks that the mu'min, the believer, the one that believes in Allah and follows Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and adheres to Islam is like every other person. But little they knew what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned, that when this caravan came and they informed the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with exactly what Abu Sufyan wanted the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to know, that the non-believers of Quraysh had gathered a large, huge number of their allies from the non-Quraysh and from the Arab to come and attack you, one man hit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says and describes the situation that the believers were in. Inna nasa qad jama'u lakum fakhshawhum. Allah is speaking about the moment when the news came to the believers that the people had gathered and gained against you, so fear them. Allah azza wa jalla said, fazadahum imana. What happened to the believers is only iman increased in their hearts. What happened to them? They did not fear anyone, but the iman just increased. And this is the state of the believer. The state of the believer, the more trials he goes through, is the more the iman goes higher. The stronger the iman becomes. Not the weaker the iman becomes. This is the quality of a munafiq, or a quality of a hypocrite, or a quality of someone with weak iman. But when the news came to the believers, when the news came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his followers, that the non-believers of Quraysh had gathered a large number of their allies to attack him, this increased their iman. This increased the iman. And what did they say? وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we turn back to you and Allah azza wa jalla rely. فَانْقَلَبُوا بِنِعْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ لَمْ يَمْسَسْهُمْ سُوءٌ وَاتَّبَعُوا رِضْوَانَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ ذُو فَضْلٍ عَظِيمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had replaced them with a bounty from upon him. Allah Azza wa Jalla had replaced them with a bounty, a great ni'mah from upon him, relaxation and calm and comfort, even though they are thinking that the number of the non-believers had increased and they are coming to attack them. This made them more comfortable. Why? Because they know they're doing this for the sake of Allah. My brother in Islam, whatever you do for Allah, you should always be comfortable. Whatever you give for Allah, you should always be relaxed. Whatever you do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the consequences are always will be the pleasure of Allah azza wa jal. وَاتَّبَعُوا رِضْوَانَ اللَّهِ. And they followed the pleasure of Allah. وَاللَّهُ ذُو فَضْلٍ عَظِيمٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has great bounties and great gifts, almighty and glory. So this move of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the next day they arrived to the Medina after the Battle of Uhud to come out to Hamra al-Asad, was a strong and firm message to the enemies of Islam, the people of Quraysh, and to all the Arabs surrounding Medina, that Muhammad and the believers are still strong and firm and willing to fight anyone that comes across them or to fight them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke over 60 verses in Surah Ali Imran mentioning the Battle of Uhud. And what happened in the Battle of Uhud? And the conclusion was, وَلَا تَهِنُوا فِي ابْتِغَاءِ الْقَوْمِ إِن تَكُونُوا تَأْلَمُونَ فَإِنَّهُمْ يَأْلَمُونَ كَمَا تَأْلَمُونَ وَتَرْجُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَرْجُونَ. This is the consequences, this is the outcome, and this is the ending result of the battle of Uhud. Allah says, do not worry about the others, the other tribe. If you were in any form of injury or hurt or pain, then they are in the same form of injury, hurt and pain. If you are in pain, they are also in pain. So if you lost, they also lost. And if you won, if they won, you also won. But the difference is, you rely on Allah and they don't. You rely on Allah and they don't. So if you were in pain, they were also in pain. And if you lost, they also lost. But there's one thing extra you have. You rely on Allah and they rely on no one except the idols they used to worship and the creation they created with their own hands. Wal-iyadu billah. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from his hikmah and wisdom, this is how far the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam used to look at. And shows you that not that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was only a prophet and a messenger, but was also a man that knew how to deal with the matters of war. A general, a commander. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a commander that alayhi salatu wa sallam knew how to deal with the affairs of war, how to deal with the affairs when it comes to fighting, and his strategies into looking into wider things than just an ordinary person. Then, obviously the Battle of Uhud had its positive outcome, but it also had its negative outcome. And one of the negative outcomes is that the news that was sent out that the Prophet ﷺ lost. And the move that the Prophet ﷺ did after that, going to Hamra al-Asad, sent a strong message to a lot of people that he's still strong. But some people, some tribes, especially those that were living around Medina, were not convinced that Muhammad is still strong. So this made them to be more selfish. This made them to be selfish to go and attack the Prophet ﷺ and attack Medina. And that's why between this, the war of, between the battle of Uhud and the Ahzab, between the battle of Uhud and the war or the battle of Ahzab or the Khandaq, the ditch, that few little battles took place, and mainly, mainly these battles took place as an outcome of the battle of Uhud and how some of the Arab tribes or Bedouin tribes tried to attack the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. From amongst those, Banu Asad bin Khuzaymah, the children of Asad bin Khuzaymah. They were a Bedouin tribe living around Medina. When they heard about the loss of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the battle of Uhud, what they did is they planned to attack Medina. And obviously during time of weakness, my brothers in Islam and my sisters in Islam, during the time of weakness or during the time of tests, during the time of trials, that's when you start realizing who's your close one and who's the far one. Who's the true believer and who's the weak believer. Who's the munafiq and not. And that's why the battle of Uhud was one of those moments that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was revealed to him, the munafiqeen. You know, those who were really hypocrites. Some of them were hiding the hypocrisy, but during the battle of Uhud, a lot of them start to unveil the hypocrisy. Some of the weak mu'mineen, those with weak iman, also start to come out. These are the, subhanAllah, these are the times that you start to know who's your friend and who's not, who's the close one to you and who's the far away from you. And during times of tests, these times of tests unveil to you who are the ones that you really depend on and those you don't. So the battle of Uhud was one of those battles, one of those events that cleared to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and unveiled to him the true believers from the untrue believers. And the munafiqeen took advantage of the battle of Uhud to plot and plan against the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's why they were sending the news to those tribes around Medina to come and invade Medina. And one of them, as we mentioned, was Banu Asad bin Khuzaymah. When the news came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the children of Asad bin Khuzaymah were planning to invade Medina and attack the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam prepared a little army of 150 fighters from the Muhajirin and the Ansar. And the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam made Abu Salama to be their leader, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave Abu Salama the flag. And yet, Abu Salama will leave Medina to go to the land, and the places of Banu Asad bin Khuzaymah. And while they were preparing to attack Medina and invade Medina, they were still in their homes. It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will that the Muslims came to their homes before they came to Medina. And it was a strong moment to crush them before they were ready to get together and attack Medina. When Abu Salama arrived to the homes and the places of Banu Asad bin Khuzaymah, their fighters just went, because they came in a moment they were not expecting anyone. So all their fighters and men were scattered and ran through the mountains and through the deserts. And Abu Salama radiallahu ta'ala anhu and his army stayed in the places and around the houses of Banu Asad bin Khuzaymah for days, just to be strong and firm and show the strength of the believers. And he came back radiallahu ta'ala anhu without even shedding a blood of a believer, or even killing even a non-believer. He came back with the booty, and he came back with the goods and the cattle that they caught within the houses of Banu Asad bin Khuzaymah. And no war, there was no fighting at all, but the Prophet ﷺ managed to crush, and the believers managed to stop what Banu Asad were planning to do towards the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Also, a few days after that, the news will come to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that Khalid ibn Sufyan al-Hudhali was preparing his own people and getting his allies from the different Arabs and Bedouins to get together and gather together and unite to fight against the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam will prepare an army led by a companion. His name is Abdullah ibn Unais radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Abdullah will go for 18 days. And he'll come back with the head of Khalid ibn Sufyan, the head leader, the head non-believer who was planning and plotting and preparing the fight against the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He came back with his head, he put it in front of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam gave that companion Abdullah ibn Unais a stick, and he said, this stick is a sign a verse between me and you in front of Allah in the hereafter. So when Abdullah ibn Ubayy radiallahu ta'ala anhu passed away, he asked that stick to be buried with him in the grave. Like in our assurance that you are from the people of the paradise, and this is a stick from me to you as the messenger of Allah, the Allah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then few months after that, my brothers and sisters, which we're saying about less than 2 months after the Battle of Uhud, another devastating battle or another devastating event or incident takes place during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which some of the scholars say was a lot worse than the Battle of Uhud. And that was Ba'th al-Raji'. Ba'th al-Raji' is a conspiracy, one of the most devastating conspiracies that ever took place with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that Ba'th al-Raji' and another one that followed it were the worst conspiracies the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had ever experienced.
Well, that's taking Shakin's herd of those 100 fighters surrounding them to fight them and kill them. That's taking Bani Nadir to flee and run into the mountains nearby their trouble. But then, those non-believers from Bani Nahiyah continue to give them the pledge and the promise that if they come down from the mountain, they'll give them peace. The most of those 10 companions, except one, their leader, Asif bin Thabit, refused to come down, but the rest came down. And when they came down, they spread away a pregnant pledge that they promised them if they come down, they'll give them peace. And they killed whatever they killed, and whoever they killed from those 10, and they sold 2 companions, Khubayb ibn Adi and Zayd ibn Thibna, to the people of Mecca. And the reason they sold those 2 companions is because those 2 companions killed many of the leaders of the people of Quraysh in the Battle of Uhud and in the Battle of Badr. And then Khubayb radiallahu ta'ala anhu is taken into Mecca, and the people of Mecca decide to crucify him. And Khubayb radiallahu ta'ala anhu is taken to At-Tab'in to be crucified. And before he was crucified radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he requested from Abu Sufyan to pray 2 rak'at Allah Azza wa Jal. So Abu Sufyan gave him the request that he prayed 2 rak'at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they put him again on the cross. And then he said, by Allah, if it wasn't for you people to say about me that I was scared and I prayed longer in the prayers, or I've stayed longer in my prayers. But just to show you, I'm not scared, and that's why I did not take long in my prayers, and here I am standing in front of you. So they put him on the cross, and there Abu Sufyan will say to him, oh, Khubayb, wouldn't you accept it? Wouldn't you accept it that Muhammad is in your place here, and you are back home sitting down with your family and your children? So radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, by Allah, I would not be happy. I will not be satisfied. I will not be content to see one spike in the messenger of Allah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's what Abu Sufyan said, by Allah, I've never ever seen anyone loving someone the way the people of Muhammad love Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam. But look at this stance. Khubayb is in a position of death. And you know, that moment, you know, a lot of people give up. A lot of people give up their dignity, give up their respect, give up their principles. But Khubayb radiallahu ta'ala anhu is asked that question, wouldn't you love it that you are sitting down amongst your family at this moment? And being suffice with your wife and your children, and Muhammad is in your place, and Khubayb responds with full confidence, by Allah, I will not even accept a spike to spite the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for I am heaven and rest. This is the love, the jealousy that these people have to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the jealousy they share to Islam. They'll do anything for Islam, and for the sake of Islam, and for the sake of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. So they crucified him radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he died radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and then one of their leaders, or one of their followers, his name is Amr ibn Ubayyah, he came in the middle of the night, took him down from the cross, and he buried him somewhere. And some narration says that the ground opened up and swallowed him. These are some of the narrations that's been narrated. It's also been narrated that while Khubayb radiallahu ta'ala anhu was locked up in a cell, radiallahu ta'ala anhu was eating grapes. in a time that grapes you could not even find in all the Arabian Peninsula. Grapes coming to him from the heavens. And this is the treatment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treats those who sacrifice in his path. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them. And Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was also captured with the Khubayb radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was given to Safwan ibn Umayyah, in which Safwan killed Zayd in return for Zayd killing his father in one of the battles that the non-believers fought against the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then another devastating event took place during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why is that this one? This one, 10 of the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhu, from the best of the companions and the most knowledgeable in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were inspired against and they were killed. But this one was worse. This one involved 70 companions. And that one, Abu Bara Amr ibn Malik, came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he comes from Najd. Najd is one of the provinces in the north, of Saudi Arabia. He came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet alayhi wa sallam called him to Islam. He did not accept, nor that he rejected Islam. He praised Islam, but at the same time, did not accept Islam. And then he said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, why don't you send a group of your men with me to go to Najd? And let them teach my people. I could see good signs of my people accepting Islam." So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "I fear on my people from the people of Najd. I'm scared from the people of Najd. I hear about them, how aggressive they are, how harsh they might be, and I'm too scared that if I send them, then the people of Najd will do something harmful to them." So Abu Bara said, "No, don't worry. I'm their ally. I'm their protector. I'll protect them, I'll give them security, and I'll give them protection." So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after consulting with the companions, he alayhi salatu wa sallam decided to send a delegation. And how many in that delegation? 70. 70 of the best reciters of the Quran al-Karim. 70 of the most knowledgeable of the companions in the Quran and the Sunnah that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had decided to be sent, with the leadership of the Mundhir ibn Amr. With the leadership of Mundhir ibn Amr. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent them on a mission. And their mission is to call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to teach the people of Najd the Quran al-Karim and to teach them Islam. Amongst them were youngsters. You know, they were young shabab. They're the ones who are putting the time and effort into the da'wah of Islam, learning the Quran, learning the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, preaching that, advocating that for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On their way, they went past the tribe of Amr ibn Tufayl. Amr ibn Tufayl was one of those hostile enemies to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who spoke about his hostility and enmity to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. Very outspoken. And on their way, Amr ibn Amr, who is a companion and the leader of the 70, he sent Haram ibn Milhad. He sent the companion Haram ibn Milhad to call Amr ibn Tufayl to Islam. He sent him with a message to call him to Islam. Haram ibn al-Had is talking to Amr ibn Tufayl. Amr ibn Tufayl rejected him in a harsh way and ordered one of his men to stab Haram ibn al-Had from behind. So while Haram ibn al-Had is calling into Allah, he sees the man coming from in front of him, being stabbed and being killed. And what does Haram ibn al-Had do? He will grab the blood of one of his hands and say, "Allahu Akbar, Fustu Rabb al-Ka'bah, Allah is the greatest, by Allah, I have succeeded the Lord of the Ka'bah." Look at these stands. The man is dying and is saying, "Allahu Akbar, Fustu Rabb al-Ka'bah, by Allah, the Lord of the Ka'bah had won, by Allah, the Lord of the Ka'bah had succeeded, by Allah, the Lord of the Ka'bah, I am victorious." What? You are dead. He knew he won the Shahada. He knew he won the martyrdom. He knew that he is now going straight to the paradise. He knew that now he is going straight to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when the news came to Al-Mundhir ibn Amr, the head and the leader, the Amir, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam aside on those 70 righteous and pious and knowledgeable companions, Al-Mundhir knew there's a conspiracy here. There's something going on. So straight away he asked his companions to get ready, like, you know, watch out what's going to happen. But yeah, it was too late, where different tribes from the Arab came and surrounded them. surrounding them. There were only 70. And you could see hundreds of the Bedouins surrounding them and throwing at them different arrows and spears. Radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Those tribes were Usayya, Ra'd, and Dakwan. There are three different tribes in which Amr ibn Tufayl managed to convince to kill their 70 companions. And Ali from the 70 companions, Ali, one companion, managed to flee and go back to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and informed the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam of the bad news. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stayed for over 30 days making dua of those tribes. They say, the companion said, we've never seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so upset, so depressed over a matter, the way he was upset and depressed over the people of the Quran. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed for over 30 days in Salat al-Fajr, and some scholars say even 5 daily prayers, making qunut on the people of the Quran and the people of Ra'd and the people of Usayya, the way they conspired against the companions and the way they killed his companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum. 70 of the best of reciters of the Quran al-Kareem, 70 of the best of knowledgeable companions that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had prepared to be the light of Islam and teachers of Islam. After that, one of the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who managed to flee from the 70 was Amr ibn Umayyah. Amr ibn Umayyah, he managed to flee and run away and reached the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On the way back to Medina, he sat and slept under a tree. And two men from the tribe of Kilab came and sat down next to him. They said, we'll sleep. You know, we just came back from Medina and we want to rest. So if you don't mind, we want to rest next to you. But Amr is so suspicious after what happened, he can't trust anyone. So when they slept, what did he do? He killed both of them. When they slept, he doesn't know them. Maybe they're going to kill him. So what did he do? He killed both of them when they went to sleep. Unfortunately, Amr radiallahu ta'ala Amr was shocked to find that they had a pledge from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that are protected by the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. They just came from the Medina, sat down with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a pledge of protection. And now Amr radiallahu ta'ala, in other words, he's from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He broke that protection and pledge. So when Amr radiallahu ta'ala went back to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told him that these are messenger of Allah. I slept under a tree and these two people from Bani Kilab came and slept next to me, but I was too scared. They were from the enemy, so I killed them while they were asleep. And I found this paper that it says there's a pledge between you and them. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I have to stick to my pledge and I have to pay the blood money. You killed them, I have to pay the blood money. And the sunnah at that time, or the contract between the Prophet ﷺ and the Jews, Bani Nadir, that if the Prophet ﷺ asks for blood money, Bani Nadir must support him, must tell the Prophet ﷺ. If there's a blood money, everyone must contribute, including the Jews. So what the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did, is that he went to Bani Nadir, which are a tribe from the Jews that were living around Medina, and they were giving the pledge and they signed the contract with the Prophet ﷺ to live peacefully and in harmony with the Prophet ﷺ. And if there is any blood money, they must share it too. So the Prophet ﷺ went to them to collect the blood money from them. What they did is they made a planning and plot against him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what they did is they asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to sit in a particular place, saying to him, O Muhammad, you sit over here while we collect the money for you. But where did they sit him down? They sat up under a wall where there was a room, and they asked who is to be the most, you know, worst one amongst them. It was his name, Amr ibn Jahash. He was the only one willing to grab a massive rock and throw it on the head of the Prophet alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was accompanied by Abu Bakr and Umar and Ali and another group of companions. Now, they asked the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to sit at this particular place where from above him they're going to throw a massive rock. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that informed the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam of the planning and plotting. When the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam sat there, just suddenly the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam got up and he went towards Medina. And the companions went behind him. What's going on, Messenger of Allah? You know, he just got up in a very, very, you know, uncommon way. Is there anything unusual way? What's happening? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continued to Medina and he said, Allah had informed me of the planning and the plotting of the Jews of Bani Nadir. What they were planning to kill me and throw a massive rock out of my head where I was sitting and where they asked me to sit. So there is no peace between us and them. Prepare the army and Bani Nadir must come out of Medina. So what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? Alayhi salatu wa salam sent a letter with Muhammad ibn Maslama radiallahu ta'ala anhu to Bani Nadir saying to them, leave Medina. Leave the city of Medina. You have 10 days. 10 days to leave the city of Medina. Or else, I'll chop your head off. This is the letter of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One line. You have 10 days. You have 10 days to leave Medina. And if you do not leave the Medina within 10 days, I'm going to come and chop your head off. Now the people of Bani Nadir start to get scared. They start to get scared. And they start to initiate leaving Medina. But who popped out of nowhere? Abdullah ibn Ubay bin Salul, who is the head of the Munafiqeen. He sent the news to the leader. He sent the news to the leader of Bani Nadir. His name is Huyay ibn Akhtab. The leader of Bani Nadir. He sent to him a letter saying to him, oh Huyay, don't leave Medina. I am with you, I've got 2,000 of my men to stand by you. I've got 2,000 of my men to stand by you. And not only that, I have spoken to Bani Najjar and other Arab tribes that are willing to stand by you. Don't worry about Muhammad and what Muhammad had threatened you to do. After 10 days, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will leave Medina and come towards Bani Nadir, where they have not left their houses, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam will put them under siege. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will put them under siege for about 18 days, and some scholars say 12 days, and other narrators say 6 days, wallahu a'lam. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put them under siege for a few days and night. And Huyay ibn Akhtab and the rest of the Jews are waiting for Abdullah ibn Ubay and said, where's the 2,000 men? Where are they? Where's Bani Najjar? Where are these people? And there Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, mentioning the cowardness of such people, لَإِنْ أُخْرِجْتُمْ لَنَخْرُجَنَّ مَعَكُمْ وَلَا نُطِعِكُمْ أَحَدٍ أَبَدًا وَإِنْ قُتِلْتُمْ لَنَصُرَنَّكُمْ. Allah is mentioning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the incident and the event of Abdullah ibn Ubay bin Salul, the head of the Munafiqeen, when he says that if you are kicked out, we're going to stand by you. If you are fought against, we're going to fight with you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then he says, if they are kicked out, they do not stand anything with them. If they are fought against, they do not fight with them. This is the quality of the hypocrites. This is the quality of those who always fight against Islam and those who fight against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jalla described that كَبَتَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِذْ قَالَ لِلْإِنسَانِ كُفُرْ فَلَمَّا كَبْرَ قَالَ إِنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِنْكَ. Allah describes that situation of Abdullah ibn Ubay bin Salul by the shaytan, when he told the human being become a disbeliever. And when the human being became a disbeliever, he said, إِنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِنْكَ, I am innocent of what you've done. And this is the example of those who are far away from the iman. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he put them under siege. As I mentioned, some narrations say 6 nights, other narrations say 15 nights, 12 nights, up to 18 nights, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam, until they surrendered to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam said, I will let you free to leave your houses with nothing more than what the camel can carry. You are not allowed to carry more than what the camel can carry. So what did they take? It's been narrated, they took with them the windows, took with them the pillars, took with them the doors. They even smashed their houses so the Muslims did not benefit from their houses after them. Look at this quality, look at this evilness. Look at this vain quality, this ugly and evil quality. They break their houses and damage their houses so that the believers enter their houses, they did not benefit from it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in Surah Al-Hashr, that Abdullah ibn Abbas used to also call Surah Al-Nadir, Bani Nadir, referring to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned about them. So they surrendered to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they went out with over 600, they went out with over 600 camels carrying their goods, carrying their treasures, carrying their luggage, and even carrying you know, the scholars say carrying the windows and the pillars and the wood and the things that, you know, you use, and then, you know, you throw just for the Muslims not to benefit from them. So this is the second tribe from the Jews that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had exiled from Medina. There's one more tribe left. We'll hear how the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam kicks it out after the battle of Ahzab, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us one amongst those who listen to me, act upon with the listen to me. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
To listen to or download more Islamic lectures, please visit www.islamicmedia.com.au.